Torrey Snow here from WBAL News Radio 1090 and FM 101.5 for another one of our special in-depth conversations. We're joined today by Brigadier General Edward S. Jones. How often do you get to hear your name read out like that?
Retired
Brigadier General. Do you refer to a Brigadier General as just General? So I'd say just General Jones. General Jones. Well, I did notice in the emails that we exchanged, and I'm going to get to your bio in just a second, but you signed off with the word Chewy. So I'm going to ask you about that in just a minute. But just so you all have a little bit of background, retired General Jones is the Assistant Adjutant General for the Air Maryland National Guard. I was just the Maryland Air National Guard. So is there...
So I was the Assistant Adjutant General for Air Maryland Air National Guard.
Got it.
Maryland National Guard.
Got it.
So there's two assistant adjutant. There's an adjutant general.
Got it.
For the whole thing.
Guard.
And then those two assistants, one for Air, one for Army.
See, this is why we have these conversations. You do have quite a bit of background. You've served as the governor and adjutant general of Maryland's principal advisor on matters pertaining to the Maryland Air National Guard. General Jones also serves as the commander of the Maryland Air National Guard, commanding an authorized strength of 1,564 officers and airmen with 21 A-10 aircraft, which is what brings us to this discussion today. He's responsible to the Adjutant General for the overall management of the flying program and ensuring units of the Maryland Air National Guard that they're organized, equipped, and trained to support federal and state missions. And I could go on. You have a really long bio, and that would take half the podcast to do that. But I will make sure we post a link so that people can learn a little bit more about your background. But I read you the formalized. Tell us a little bit about who you are and what your role with the Maryland Air National Guard is.
Okay, again, I'm retired.
Got it.
Retired back in January of this year. So as the, like say, assistant adjutant general, so the way the National Guard is set up is you have an adjutant general, and that's a two-star general. He can be Air or Army. He is appointed by the governor, works directly for the governor, but he also has federal authority as well. He's a federally recognized officer. General Jeanine Burkhead, runs the entire National Guard umbrella for the state. Under that, you have the Air National Guard and the Army National Guard. In Maryland, about 1,500 for Air and about 4,500 or so for Army. So about 6,000 National Guardsmen in Maryland total.
Your responsibility was over the Air.
So my responsibility was the commander of the Air National Guard. Mm-hmm. Yes, that's correct.
Awesome.
In some states, you have multiple wings, like we talked about Pennsylvania a little while ago, three or four wings up there in Pennsylvania, big state, big National Guard presence. Maryland, we're a one-wing state, although we have a very robust wing. It's a larger wing than most wings with 1,500 people. Most wings are about 1,200 people. And we have the luxury of having two mission sets. So we have a flying operation, so an ops group, flying A-10s, and then we have a cyber group as well, and by far the biggest cyber presence in the National Guard in the whole country is here in Maryland.
Really? Well, yes. That doesn't surprise me, right? Because you've got a huge technical presence.
Absolutely,
here.
You've
got a lot of
yes.
resources
yes.
that are locally. But you're here because of the discussion we've been having, and it's in the news, that there is discussion about a potential mission change for the Maryland Air National Guard. And
that's correct.
Part of that involves an ongoing desire over the past, three decades or so. But the seems like we're getting a little more movement on the potential retirement of the air wing of the Air National Guard for Maryland, which does comprise of that flight of A-10s.
That's correct.
And so give us a little bit of background about how we got to this point today. Like, why are we talking about mission changes? And, when they say they're retiring the A-10s, what does that mean practically for us here?
So for a long time, the wing there at Martin State had two groups in it, two flying groups. It had an ACC or an air combat group with the A-10s, going back to prior to that, F-86s, A-37s, P-51s, all the way back. And then it also had a mobility group as well, it flying C-130s, and at the very end there, they flew the C-27 for a little while. The decision was made back in the 2000s that the mobility part of that of the wing would lose their airplanes. Those airplanes went away, and to replace those jobs, we brought on cyber. We always had a small cyber piece, the Network Warfare Squadron, which we've had for about 25 years, one of the very first ones actually in the Guard. And again, because of our location here with NSA, Cybercom, Fort Meade, prime location. Like I say, we lost that flying wing on the mobility side, and we picked up cyber. So that flying group became a cyber group. In that cyber group, we have four squadrons. Actually, it's up to five squadrons now. There's two offensive cyber squadrons.
Hackers, basically? Is that an overly overly simplified way of describing it?
I'll just leave it at offensive.
Okay.
So there's only three offensive cyber squadrons in the Air National Guard, and we have two of them here in Maryland.
All right.
The other one's in Delaware. We have a defensive cyber squadron, and then we also have an OSS, which is an operational support squadron, and their job is to train cyber operators. And then we recently had a standalone intel squadron, cyber intel squadron, and we brought that in under their group as well. Those guys and gals do great work all over the place.
So. And we're gonna get to the airplanes in just a minute, but I'm just curious. Why is cyber primarily a function of the Air Force, or are there other branches that have their own cyber?
So everybody kind of has their own cyber thing going on. I would say that the Air Force is probably the largest of cyber. Mm-hmm. Space Force now too is heavily into cyber, I believe. But Air Force, yes, is very heavy into cyber, and we do it better than anybody. There's no doubt. It's the truth. We're very good at it, and we're very good at it here in Maryland.
Okay, so our beloved A-10s, and by the way, I have a few A-10 flying experience hours myself, but they're on a video game, so it doesn't count. But I have a long personal history with the A-10. I was at a friend's house. It was an elderly lady that used to watch us as kids, and she had this old computer and didn't have many games on it, but there was a game called A-10 Tank Killer. It was an old MS-DOS game, came on four floppy disks, and every time we'd go over to her house, I played this. This is probably like late 80s, early 90s video game, and that was where I first discovered the concept of the A-10, right? And this was back in the early 90s, but the A-10 itself, which is what you fly, has developed a bit of a cult following, so to speak, and Maryland's Air Guard unit comprises of A-10, and you are an A-10 pilot. You are an A-10 maintainer. Tell us a little bit about the A-10 aircraft itself and why it has this kind of mythos surrounding it.
So a little history on the A-10, and we talked about this a little bit last week when I called in. You know, the Air Force has had a tendency to kind of want to – the Air Force has always been very – forward thinking as far as technology. After World War II, we came into the jet age, and the Air Force decided that we don't need any of these prop airplanes anymore. We can do everything with jets. Jets are the future, flying high and fast, and you know, we're not ground wars are it's all about air to air and stuff like that. And they parked all the propeller airplanes, all the airplanes that could fly a little lower, fly slower, really cover the troops on the ground, close air support mission. That the P-51s and the P-47s did for the Air Force or for the Army Air Corps in World War II, and the F-4 used for the Navy and Marine Corps. Well, Korea came along, and it's like, holy cow, we have all these troops on the ground. They need support. We can't really do it with these jets. Let's bring these airplanes basically out of the boneyard. So they brought the P-51s
the propeller
back.
Planes that we used in World War II.
Propeller planes back, yes. Brought the P-51s back, brought the F-4Us back. And they did that close air support mission in Korea. Well, time goes on, you know, more jets. They park all those airplanes. Around the end of World War II, they had started developing an airplane that it later became the A-1, the Sky Raider? It was the A-1. Air Force and Navy had it. Prop plane, big prop, big Pratt & Whitney engine on it. So, luckily, they kind of built a whole bunch of them, but they never used them because it was the end of the war, and they parked them all, and they just sent them to the boneyard for the most part. Well, Vietnam comes along. Here we are again. We have all these jets. We have people on the ground that need close air support. What are we going to do? Well, they brought the A-1s out of the boneyard, and the A-1 did a lot of close air support in Vietnam. They did a lot of the combat search and rescue in Vietnam, the A-1s did. So about that time, somebody got smart, and it really goes back to some really smart folks that worked in the Pentagon that we don't have enough time to talk about all them, Pierre Sprague and some other folks that decided, hey, we need to have, you know, instead of just having this one airplane, which was really the F-4 back in those days, the Army, the Marine, or the Air Force, the Marines, and the Navy all flew the F-4. It was the Barry Goldwater one airplane. It's going to cover everything. We need some separate airplanes for some different missions here. That's when the F-15, F-16 as an interceptor, F-15 is as an air-to-air dominant airplane, and then the A-10 as that air-to-ground close air support airplane came into thought, was designed, started flying early 70s. So, you know, we got our airplanes here at Martin State in 1979, right out of the factory, right out of Hagerstown.
Really?
Yeah. So the airplane was built by Fairchild Republic, which was a Long Island company, but they had their facility where they actually put the airplanes together was right here in Hagerstown.
I did not know that. Yeah. So we built the A-10s here.
The A-10 was built right in Hagerstown.
Can we talk a little bit about the construction? I won't go too deep into this because I do want to get to the mission and how it's changing. But the actual aircraft itself, the A-10, it is designed, and many people describe it as a titanium bathtub with a giant gun.
Yeah. So they say, you know, the A-10, they had this gun. They designed this gun, this galley, you know, gun cannon, 30-millimeter cannon that could shoot like no other gun that's ever been designed, 4,200 rounds a minute. Shell that's, you know, about that long, you know. So they basically had to design the airplane around this gun. Okay, we have this gun that we want to be able to put it airborne. Now, how are we going to do this? So they designed this airplane.
So is that true? I used to think that was just a joke. They designed the plane around the gun.
Yeah. So they designed this airplane around the gun, and it's like, okay, this airplane's going to do close air support. It's going to have to fly low. It's not real fast. We're going to have to really make this thing heavy duty. So things like the titanium bathtub that the pilot sits in, all the redundancy, everything on the A-10 is done for a reason. The engines are mounted external. They're not internal. So if an engine does get hit, you can lose an engine. An engine can take a missile or take, you know, something, but it doesn't destroy the whole airplane because it's an external engine. It'll keep flying on the other engine. Everything on that airplane is redundant to the point that, you know, two tails. The way the tails are designed to kind of shield the exhaust a little bit for the heat signature. It has a backup cable system, which, you know, no airplanes nowadays hardly has. So if the hydraulics go out, you can still fly the airplane. It's just, it's very, very heavy duty.
And maybe for people that aren't familiar, you know, the concept of close air support, maybe I think that if people understand the design of this aircraft tells you how dangerous it is to fly these aircraft, right? Specifically in a combat situation. There are different considerations when you're flying close air support. Can you tell us a little bit about the risks that are posed? You
know, so the risk with close air support is basically is you're low to the ground and you're slow because you need to be that way because the primary weapon for close air support with the A-10 is that 30-millimeter cannon because nothing as precise as pointing a gun and pulling the trigger and because you know exactly where that bullet's going. Missiles can stray, bombs can blow, wind can blow. When you pull the trigger with that gun, and that's where that bullet is going. Mm-hmm. So when it comes to troops in contact, you know, our friendly forces are on the ground, and they're in contact with enemy forces that are extremely close, that's the weapon of choice for them, is that 30-millimeter gun. Why the 30-millimeter? Because it's the biggest gun out there, right. Basically. As far as most fighters have a 20-millimeter, and it doesn't have the range, it doesn't have the kinetic energy that the A-10. Every one of those bullets that's in a 30-millimeter shell, it's like a hand grenade. And there's different designs on those bullets. Some of them are armor-piercing. Some of them are high center, so they're like a little bomb explosion. Like say, some of them put out armor-piercing for shooting tanks that penetrate through 8 inches of armor. things like that. So it's just a great weapon.
So this is an extraordinary part of the U.S. arsenal. It sounds like it's extremely valuable to the, you know, the troops on the ground, and I'm told that it's still being used, right? These aircraft regularly. In fact, let's talk a little bit about your career, because you were a pilot, and you have an interesting background about how you came to be a pilot. If you can, just a couple minutes, tell us what was your path to getting in the cockpit of an A-10?
So my path was being an enlisted crew chief, a maintainer, joining the Guard or joining the Air Force because I wanted to work on airplanes. I thought it was cool, you know, kind of an airplane geek. And once I got into the Guard, I realized that the opportunities that the Guard presented to me, if you work hard, you know, you keep your nose clean and you do your job. I started going to school. I hadn't gone to any college before that, so community college here locally. You know, I was a local kid, Baltimore County High School, you know, public schools. And I started doing the community college thing while I was at the Guard part-time, working full-time, doing some odds and ends, different jobs. And then eventually quitting my full-time job so I could finish up school, get my four-year degree at Towson, and then I was lucky enough to get selected to go to pilot training, become an officer, and came up that way. So that's a little bit different way. We do a lot of that, but some pilots we hire right off of active duty. Mm-hmm. Some pilots that we send to pilot training aren't local, but they're just highly qualified, so they apply from all over the country and we are selected. And then we have some pilots, other ones like me, that came up just like I did in the unit. So you can really. It's an opportunity for a kid, men and women, you know, to join the Guard basically with no money, mm-hmm. you know, nothing other than a high school education, and if you work hard and do everything right, you know,
true meritocracy.
It is absolutely.
The military is one of those remaining meritocracies. It is. And does it take a special type of person to be an A-10 pilot? Because I mean, I'm sure you have. There's lots of aircraft out there. I feel like mentally, like if you know you're getting in this aircraft that's designed to be probably closer to the enemy than any other aircraft that's out there.
I think it takes a little bit different person to be a fighter pilot in general. Mm-hmm. So, you have to be aggressive. Mm-hmm. You have to kind of live. I don't want to say that. It's hard to say.
How close is it to Top Gun? We could ask that. How close is it to Top Gun? When you look at Top Gun, that's like the Hollywood portrayal of the these pilots and everything. I've always been curious.
So fighter pilot in general, yes, it is kind of close, although not near as corny. You
know? No volleyball on the beach.
But as far as the A-10, so the thing that the A-10 kind of stands alone is the fact that we are absolutely dedicated to our brothers on the ground. We're the Army's best friend, we're the Marine Corps' best friend, because they know that we're going to be there for them. And I've seen so many instances in my career where the pilot just went above and beyond and really kind of hung it out there, mm-hmm. because of these troops on the ground, because sometimes that's the only link that they have, is that radio, that airplane in the sky is their only protection. And it's actually a pretty cool feeling when you can do this mission and you can support those troops on the ground. Because like I say, I've had circumstances where I'll throw one out there. I remember one time in Afghanistan, middle of the night, you talk about a place that's really dark. When it's nighttime in Afghanistan, it's dark. I have a mission. I push forward out a couple hundred miles, make radio contact with this JTAC, Joint Terminal Air Controller. He's another guardsman. He was an Illinois guardsman, I believe, at that time. And it's him, his interpreter, and about 50 Northern Alliance troops. That's it.
Wow.
On the ground. And they're taking fire. And I'm his link to surviving, basically.
Wow.
And the other thing the A-10 does so many times, I mean, we do a lot of really good work. I mean, we drop bombs, we fire the gun, we do what we need to do when we do it. But I tell you what, more missions than not, over 90% of the missions I thought were really successful is because we didn't have to do that. Just showing up,
Yeah.
And so we would.
Well, I'm sure it sends a message to the enemy, like, oh,
absolutely. They don't, they don't want to mess with an A-10. And just showing up overhead, we do what's called a show of force, make a low pass. At night, we carry self-protection flares. We'll put out a couple flares so they know we're there. And that's all it takes. And that night, that was it. And I stayed with that guy, my wingman and I. You know, we rotated back and forth to the tanker when we get low on gas. And we probably spent about 5 hours with him that night until the sun started to come up. And they were able to, you know, get away from where they were and get out of that area and stop taking fire. But that's the kind of missions that really make you.
And
they appreciate it so much. And they would show up, you know, when they got a chance to get out of the field and come to where we were flying out of, either Bagram or Kandahar or whatever, they would come and find us.
Wow.
All the time, just thank us for missions. You know,
so that does bring us to the mission here in Maryland, right? The Maryland Air National Guard, it has an A-10 wing, discussions about potentially moving it out. We talked a little bit about the tug of war between cyber and, you know, an air unit. Do you feel pretty strongly that an air unit adds a lot of value to Maryland's Air National Guard?
So here's what an air unit brings. So the way the Guard is set up, you're a Constitution guy.
Yep.
Posse Comitatus. Basically, what that means is that was an act that was done. Basically, that's why the active duty federal forces can't really do anything in this country.
Right.
Well, the Guard, on the other hand, can. And the reason is, so as a guardsman, when you're sworn in, you take a federal oath and you also take a state oath.
Right.
So that's why the governor has some control over the Guard. The governor of each state has, and it says right in the Constitution, is allowed to raise a militia. Well, the militia that it talks about in the Constitution is the Guard. It's not the federal, because it also talks about the armies.
Right.
Well, that's the federal
armies,
forces. Yeah. The militia is the Guard. So the advantage of the Guard is, for the state, what it brings is, for one, it doesn't really cost the state a lot, because we are federally trained. Our Martin State Airport is a federal installation. It's all federally funded for our training. But yet, when the governor needs us, the governor can take us as guardsmen and put us on what's called state active duty. So because we take that dual oath, then we work directly for the governor. And that's why the Guard, you'll see, has police, basically, they can do police actions, you know.
I believe our unit had a rescue just the other day, right?
Yeah, they did it. Yeah, with the fire department. Uh-huh. Yeah, and I'll get to the fire department here in a second. But yeah, so that's why in 2015, streets of Baltimore, the governor called up, 2,500 or so guardsmen, 500 of those were air guardsmen. Down here in Baltimore, I came down and saw them at the Inner Harbor, and my guys were out there walking around, And like I say, the federal forces cannot do that mission. So that's something right there that the Guard brings. So, and the thing is, so when the governor puts those folks on state active duty, so then that's coming out of the state budget. And like
right.
I say, they're strictly working for the governor. Now, what ends up happening, why this can really be a good deal for the governors, is once a federal emergency is declared, then the federal government will pick up, through FEMA, they pick up the tab for that. So those forces still work for the governor, but the federal government then pays the bill.
Hmm.
That's a great deal for governor.
So, I mean, does a governor have use for a flight unit?
Like,
I can't imagine.
I've been asked this question a lot. I've been asked this question a lot. And is the governor going to use A-10s? Let's hope not. Let's hope things never get that bad, But here's what my folks in that A-10, those 500 or so folks that are directly supported to the A-10 in that mission, what they bring. They bring that military skill set that basically can be used for anything. We have done so many different things. For instance, COVID. So we ran an M&T bank. That was an Air Guard. The Air Guard ran that facility for vaccines and testing. You know, our folks, like I say, they're so diverse in the way they think and the training that they've had and those leadership skills that they have. And like I say, just the skill sets, they were very hands-on with that military training that they get. And then they also have that civilian training, depending on what they do on the civilian side, they bring that as well. And I can say that any time that we're called for something like that, we are always so successful, because there's going to be a couple folks somewhere in that 500 people that work in maintenance or whatever, there's bodies basically that, oh, I've done, you know, on my outside job. And that's the thing that the guard brings. All these folks have, they work on the outside and they bring all this knowledge in, you know. So that's what brings, that's why that flying wing is important. Now, here's the other thing that flying wing. You brought up the fire department. So the fire department at Martin State Airport, that's a state airport, but that fire department is a federal, you know, it's a guard. So that fire department that's down there 24/7 is totally funded through the federal government. So it doesn't cost the state of Maryland anything to have a full up and running, highly trained fire department at that state airport. The other things that the flying wing actually encompasses, when you have airplanes, you get a lot of different missions in your guard wing, security forces. The reason we have security forces there is because when those airplanes deploy, they need to have security. Mm. So we have a security forces squadron that, if you don't have airplanes, you know, a cyber building is a brick building with a cipher lock on it. Do you need security forces for that? You know,
right.
There's plenty of those around DC and all that. No, you don't. You know, so there's a lot of things that flying wing brings. Like I say, all those maintenance troops, yeah, they're bodies that can be used for multiple things. We can put an M16 in that airman's hand, mm-hmm. and put him on the street of Baltimore if he's needed. We have a logistics capability that comes with those airplanes. That's fantastic. We have civil engineering that comes to take care of the main, yeah. to take care of the facilities that take care of those airplanes. Again, that's all things that come with the flying wing. All that money that comes for flying airplanes is paid for all that as well. Without the airplanes, those now they can promise you this and that, but I think my experience has told me there's a large possibility that we're going to lose a lot of that other capability. Now, does cyber bring a capability for the governor? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. You know, we can also put our cyber folks who have great backgrounds that work in the best cyber, you know, big contracting companies, three-letter agencies for the government. We have them all. You know, they, especially being where we are here, well, in Baltimore and close to D.C.
It feels a bit, I'm sorry to cut you off there, but it feels like a big win to have both. Right,
absolutely.
There's not many flight, you know, units.
No, we're the only wing. We're the only wing in the guard that has both in the whole country. Wow. And it's great to have both. You have everything you need. You can only use so much cyber as far as in a domestic role. You know, when we help out the state with cyber, it's funny. Like you'll hear about hacks here and there. Mm-hmm. So we'll work it through the governor's office. We'll call and. You know, they'll bring a couple folks in on state active duty because they can't do it federally, but they can do it state, you know, as a state employee. And we'll send two or three people there, and they'll take care of it. It's amazing.
That's amazing.
Well, yeah, because they're so good at what they do.
This has been really enlightening. I thank you for taking time to come out and check us out here at the studio and to share the mission. And I'm sure there's going to be more information. Where can people learn more about the Maryland Air National Guard?
On you can just Google Maryland Air National Guard. They have a Facebook page. It has a lot of information on it. There's a lot of information out there.
And
I do want to talk about one more thing real quick. Sure. And we talked about it a little bit last week. So right now, like I say, the Air Force is kind of there's two things here we're talking about. One is the A-10 going away.
Right.
The other is the entire flying mission going away. So right now there's 25 fighter squadrons in the Air National Guard. 23 of them right now have a follow-on mission. So they're flying something right now that's either going to be around for a long time or it's going to go away, but they have, okay, so this unit that has A-10, like Boise, Idaho, we talked about, right. They've already said, okay, we're gonna bring some F-16s from someplace, and so you're going to fly the F-16 after you fly the A-10, and it'll probably carry them through to some F-35 or something like that. The two states that don't have a follow-on mission are Michigan and Maryland. They both fly the A-10. The difference with Michigan is they actually have, in their flying wing, they have two flying operations. They have a KC-135, a tanker group, and then they have the A-10 group. So if they lose the A-10, they'll still have a flying mission in their state. If we lose the A-10 and make, and what they're kind of talking about, well, we can make you a bigger cyber. Yeah, we could probably do that, but how much cyber do we need, really? Like I say, I think it's more important that each state, cyber brings a lot to the governor and domestically. Each state should have a little bit of that. Wouldn't that be great?
Yeah, absolutely.
Every governor in the union has a chance to have. They don't right now. Cyber's fairly small within the guard. So, and we feel it's very important for us to keep our flying mission. So, am I absolutely dedicated to the A-10 and the close air support role? 100%. I think it's wrong to get rid of the airplane, but if that's what the Air Force is eventually going to do, because the airplanes are pushing 50 years old, although they're in great shape and we've re-winged them and spent a lot of money keeping them where they are, they'll last a long time. But if that's what the Air Force wants to do, well, then that's fine. But then at least what we need to do then is get a follow-on fighter to follow, you know, for the A-10.
Because
we
keep a flight wing
here. we have this experience. You know, we have these maintainers. We have these pilots. So let's use that. Because if I can tell you, if you go to a cyber mission, most of those maintainers, you know, there's a couple, some of them will go. Some of the folks that used to work on 130s went to, but most of them left and just either retired, quit the guard, or went to other states. They went to Pennsylvania or they went to Delaware and things like that. We're going to lose the majority of that talent.
And if we decide we need them, it's going to be hard to get them back. Right?
You can't bring that back from, once it's gone for forever. So our big push has been, we need a follow-on. You know, we've done a lot of work with the runway. That initially, we didn't qualify for a follow-on fighter because of our runway at Martin State. It's 8,100 feet of concrete, but over the years, they've displaced the threshold and taken it down to about 7,000 feet, which it falls under the 8,000-foot mandatory for the Air Force for a fighter. But we've got that fixed. We've got money. Dutch Ruppersberger has been fantastic, helping us out. You know, he's a HACD, House Appropriations Committee Defense.
Right.
So he's gotten his money for the runway. Matter of fact, they're going to start that project in the spring.
Oh, nice.
So we're going to get our 8,000-foot runway back. So they've got some other things they need to do, but it's all projected out.
But if they move the unit out, you won't need it, right? It's just, I mean, it's still at Martin State, but
it doesn't
do the military any good, and you guys are making this investment into this.
It's an investment into the state. The state, this is something that the state had wanted to do, but the state couldn't afford it. But now with this DOD money coming in, now they can afford to do this, and they can fix this runway and bring it back to 8,000 feet like it was originally. Wow. So that's already in the works. That is happening. The contract's already been awarded to a local Baltimore company, which is great.
All right.
Construction company, jobs, you know. So that train has already left the station as far as getting our runway fixed. So now it's just a matter of, okay, we don't want to be that last unit that ends up short with no. And the thing is, like, the combatant, the Air Force really has a problem, because the commander of the Air Combat Command, he has been saying repeatedly that he needs 60 fighter squadrons to, and that's active guard and reserve, 60 fighter squadrons to basically do the mission. That's what I need to support the combat commanders all over the world. Right now there's 55. And they're talking about taking more away.
How many A-10 units are there?
I think we're down to, so in the Guard, there's Maryland, Michigan, Fort Wayne, which has already started a conversion to the F-16, and Boise. In the Reserve, there's a squadron at Moody Air Force Base. There's a squadron at Davis-Monson Air Force Base. I believe there's three in the Reserve, four in the Guard. And then there's active duty squadrons as well. We still have A-10s in Korea. There's active duty squadrons in Arizona. There's active duty squadrons in Georgia.
Got it.
So there's probably 10, 12.
But, I mean, now is not a great time to be cutting units.
No. we talk a lot. The focus now is on China. And it's a high threat area. You know, there's no doubt it's a higher threat than Afghanistan, which was a very low threat for flyers there. But just to get rid of the experience and to get rid of the airplane, the one thing that the airplane does very well, the A-10, is we always say it's like a truck. you can hang more weapons on that thing. So you don't have to get, you know, and the weapons nowadays, you don't have to get real close to the battlefield to engage with these weapons. Mm-hmm. The A-10 is a truck, man. It can put a, you can put a lot of, the A-10 has come a long way with the technology. Yeah, is it big and slow? But yes, but it's got some defensive capabilities that are classified stuff that's
right.
It's way farther along than most people.
Do you get to fly often these days?
So I don't fly, like I say, I retired. Mm-hmm. I actually didn't get to fly about my last 5 years of my career. Once you make general officer, it's kind of hard to fly and
can't
stuff like that.
Can't actually do axle work anymore, right?
Yeah. So my whole career, I've other than working for the Guard a little bit back in the 90s full time, and then doing a year here active duty or deploying active duty here, that I've worked for United Airlines.
So you still get to fly regularly.
I'm an airline pilot.
That's good. So. Wow. Yeah. Just not the fun stuff anymore.
Yeah, right,
you can't
right.
do your fun maneuvers in the
right.
A-10.
No.
Are there maneuvers that only the A-10 can do? Like, are there specific A-10 type flight maneuvers? It's just for fun, right?
I would say no, because any fighter slow, yeah. can do those things. I mean, we can.
But
do,
I mean, there has to be like a specialized. Like, I'm sure you can't fly an A-10 the way that you would fly an F-16 because of the way the mission is. I'm guessing that's just
right,
my speculation.
Right. That's true.
You just have to fly it differently.
Yeah, that's true. But the air. So what we always say about the A-10 is it's a very easy airplane to fly. Airplanes with straight wings are usually easier airplanes to fly. They're very what we call forgiving. Mm-hmm. So you can kind of let go of the airplane, and the airplane wants to fly.
Right.
You know, it doesn't need a computer to keep it flying. It's just naturally the way it's designed. It wants to fly. But what we say is, like say, it's an easy airplane to fly, but an extremely hard airplane to operate. Mm. Because in that cockpit, you have multiple radios. You're in communication with on SATCOM. You're on, like say, three or four different radios. You're talking to different people. You're talking to people on the ground at the same time. You're talking to the AWACS. And it's very when you're dealing with troops on the ground in very close proximity of where you're dropping weapons or shooting that gun, it becomes very difficult.
Yeah, so you have to train your brain in
a lot of A-10 has a lot of sensors on it now that it never had before when I first started flying. That it's got great capabilities. That it, like I say, it's been fantastic. They've really brought the airplane along, even though it looks the same. It's a totally different airplane than it was 30 years ago.
Is it theoretically possible to design a new A-10, like
absolutely.
A plane with a similar, taking all the good things and just evolving it?
Yes, I believe so, yeah.
Well, maybe we've
re-winged our A-10s. Most of the airplanes at Martin State, I think just about all except two or three of them, and they're still programmed to get new wings. So the big thing with the A-10 was the wing. We fixed that. They put new wings. The Air Force twice has done a wing contract with Boeing and then canceled it and then came back and did it again because they kept thinking they were going to get rid of the A-10. But since the first Gulf War, the A-10 has been in continuous use. And even right now, the A-10s are downrange.
Someone messaged my show and said that they're planning to go somewhere this spring.
Yes.
Wow.
Our A-10s at Martin State are going east this spring.
Wow.
Again. So to say that the A-10 doesn't have a mission, you know, It's kind of...
Well, I'll give you a couple moments. Do you want to make a pitch for people to consider joining the Air National Guard?
So, like I say, the Air National Guard is... Yeah, I would. It's a great job. It was great for me. Like I say, I spent 38 years there, kind of started with nothing and ended up as the kind of the number one guy, which was pretty cool. Pay for college. You know, if that's a concern, good military benefits. Good retirement once you get your 20 years, it's a great way of life. But it's not your whole way of life. So like I say, for those folks out there that just kind of want to do something with their hands, you know, get out of the office and go work on something or be around military jets or have that little military camaraderie. Again, it's still just a one weekend a month. It's very the one thing about the Guard is very good about it. We'll take whatever you can give us. So, yes, you have to do your one weekend a month and your 2 weeks out of the year, and we're probably going to ask you for a little more there. But when you do that little bit more, it comes with traveling to cool places, you know, deployments to Alaska for training, deployments all over the United States for training. And the Air National Guard has, and the National Guard in general has a thing called the State Partnership Program, SPP. It's a great program through the State Department. We have two countries here in Maryland that we represent. Estonia is one of them. You probably see a lot of stuff. you guys report on a lot of stuff. Mm-hmm. I see that the Guard is doing with Estonia.
Right, right.
That's why, because they are our state partners. So we go to Estonia at least once a year. We take A-10s. We take a lot of people. We take cyber folks. Estonia is like the cyber. They're the cyber powerhouse in Europe. So we have a great relationship that way with them. And then our other country is Bosnia-Herzegovina. So we haven't had those. We haven't had them quite as long. We've had them about 20 years, I think, 15, 20 years. Again, so we are very involved in that sort of thing. So we go to those countries a lot in Europe. There's a lot of opportunities for travel. Again, not mandatory, always voluntary. So it's just a great experience.
What's the age limit? Is there an age limit to join the Guard?
You know, they keep pushing it up, but I think it's at least 40.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Interesting. Maybe I'll be making a call.
And even flying now. Flying used to be 27 and a half or so, yeah. and I got in just kind of under the wire. But even flying now, I think you can go to pilot training into your 30s.
Early 30s. That is very fascinating. Well, General Jones, thanks so much for your time. Thank you for all the work that you have done throughout your career and for coming and spending time and educating us on this very important decision. And keep us posted, right? As things continue, maybe they'll keep us updated on the progress of the field. And I know we at least see I know sometimes they do flyovers with the A-10s. That's you guys, right?
Yeah, I actually did the Ravens flyover. I led that flyover probably for about 10 years straight. My first one was a playoff game against the Denver Broncos in 2000 before we went to the
nice.
Super Bowl. And I probably did that for about, because I'm a local guy, so I kind of know all the landmarks. And Ravens flybys, Orioles flybys, 4th of July flybys. and that's just another way to kind of get, you know, not only when we do those flybys, it's actually hard. So the pilots are getting training. There's nothing harder than, you know, when you have 70,000 people and in those stands and you need to make that TOT like to the second, and whoever sings the national anthem, you don't know if they're going to be a little fast, a little slow, and that's very hard to do. So we get a lot of good training. We generally go out and fly, and we'll do other missions, and then we'll hit that at the end and do the flyby. So people that think that that's a waste of money, those pilots are getting counters, sorties that they need to get, and they're getting good training out of that. So
that's really, really
great. Yeah, it's a great recruitment tool as well.
Well, next time you look up in the sky and see those A-10 zooming by, think about General Jones and the work that they're doing out at Martin State Airport. Thanks so much for joining us today. Have a great time.
Thank you, Torrey.